on in. Saw a world full of trouble now. I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. Yeah. I created you. Now listen. If not.
For the chance to share with you a little bit about the amazing things God did just a week ago when we were in Kentucky serving with Appalachia Service Project. Before we get started with pictures and stories, we do want to take a minute to mention some things that are important for our church family and for our community. Tonight at 6 will be another picnic at the beach. If you haven't been to one of these, it's a really great time. It isn't anything you really have to do anything to prepare for. Show up out at the North Muskegon State Park by the beach on the south side of the bathhouse shelter there, in the parking lot. someone's going to have a grill. You can bring meat if you want meat to throw on the grill. Bring something to share. You get busy and don't have time to make something, stop and get a bag of chips. That's perfectly okay. You never know what you're going to find, but it's always fun. You can stay and swim, stay and visit, eat and leave, whatever you like. So remember that at 6 o'clock tonight. Pastor Phil has a couple of things, too.
Great. Welcome, everybody. First of all, Kim, are the kids to stay here today, or are they to go out when it's time maybe to go to Children's Church? Do you want them in the room for the whole day? Okay, kids get to stay. But I do want the kids to know that there's something really special coming up. What's coming up Thursday night? Does anybody know Thursday night? There's a parade, and we have typically been a part of that parade. We've had a little float and reminded people of our kickoff in the fall. This year we're going to do it a little different. We're going to remind people of the kickoff for the fall by throwing these rubber bracelets out to the kids along the way. And we had 1,100 of these last year, and we did not make the whole distance of the parade. So it is really great. And I noticed a lot of organizations publicize things along the parade route with little sheets of paper of this and that. And after the parade, it's kind of like there's junk all up and down the street. But guess what? I checked. There wasn't a single rubber bracelet along the street last year. So these go home with people. And they have the dates of our fall startup, which you saw in the entryway. So I want kids to come on down right now and grab a rubber bracelet so you can have one first. So any of the kids that want to have a rubber bracelet, come on down. And you guys can grab the favorite color you want so you can get that. So go for it. Any kids that are here. And if you want to take a second one for a friend, you're welcome to as well. So they'll be back in the back after the service. I knew I'd get a couple extras coming down. But one other announcement, Ellen helped me here. We have a young woman in our school here that's been in an awful car accident. You guys know who I'm talking about. What is her name?
Brianna.
And her mom is having to make trips back and forth to Grand Rapids. And so I think there's an effort to try to support this family in the midst of all this. Ellen, what are they doing and how do we participate?
What we're doing is just a gift card drive for the McIntosh family. As Julie is driving back and forth to Grand Rapids, Rhiannon has had, I think, 4 surgeries this week so far and is spending time at DeVos Children's Hospital. So if you feel inclined, either you can give us cash and we'll get gift cards for Julie for gas, for takeout, for groceries, for anything that we can do for the family just to make it easier for them. Julie is a single mom. She used to be the janitor here at church, and Rhiannon was a member when she was a kid here at church. But they're a member of the community, and we thought we could help them by just a gift card drive.
That is so cool. So I'm glad for that. I'll give it back to you, and we'll get any other announcements covered.
Don't go away, Phil. I need you for a second. Okay, Family Promise of the Lakeshore, where we are part of a ministry that takes care of homeless families. We take people who are evicted. We take families who are living in cars. I mean, really, really rough situations. And our church network gives them homes, helps them get support. They stay with us, and we get them into a home with their family. They're in really big financial trouble, aren't they, Phil?
Yeah.
Phil's on the board. Their director has not taken a paycheck in 2 months. That's how broke they are. They're doing this fun thing at Ross Park in Norton Shores. It's going to be a Sunday afternoon, August 23rd. They're going to have a carnival for kids, and their fundraiser is a rowboat regatta. You're looking at our captain. We're going to have a couple of people paddling his boat for him. But rather than have 30 people try and do boats, we're just going to have one boat, and we are going to raise money for it. So, Phil, this is going to be the beginning of the collection for our team. It's empty now, but we have until August 23rd to fill this. So,
where will this be?
This will be out in the gathering room each Sunday after worship, and you can find me there and the rubber duck, and we're going to fill Phil's boat.
We don't know who the rowers are.
We don't have rowers yet. We're looking for a couple of strong people to row. And we need a couple of paddles because you don't get to use oars. You have to use canoe paddles with these rowboats. So if anybody has a couple of canoe paddles, you can bring them in and leave them in the gathering room. We need a couple of paddles. And then we're going to need to find the 2 strongest people
Well,
to paddle.
You.
So we're gonna do you proud, Phil.
Well, you need a skinnier basket, but you got what you got.
I have a couple more things. And I'm going to take this opportunity to say 25 years ago, what brought me in the doors of a United Methodist Church was its heart for mission, as you're going to see now. And Appalachia Service Project, and they went out and did a big thing in the world. And we got to do small things to help them get there. And there are many other small things. And I think that's one of the reasons we come on Sunday morning. Not just to hear the word, not just to share prayer concerns, but to find out what we're supposed to do when we leave this place. So we have a blood drive coming up. It's Tuesday, August 11th. And so if you can donate, we'd love to see you on that Tuesday afternoon. I can no longer give because of a medical problem, so I volunteer at the blood drive. If you can't give, find someone who can and have them give in your place. So if you can't give, tag someone else. And the last thing in my box, Ava, could you come up and bring your friend here? I need help. Helper, helper, helper. Helper, helper, helper. This is the MAP food pantry. What does that say? Here, take that one. I got another one. What kind of helper is that? Do you know? What does that one say? Tuna. Tuna helper. What does that one say? Chicken. Take that. Grab it. All right. And I've got the last one. Hamburger helper. Come up here, girls. Hold them up high. Helper, helper, helper. MAP Food Pantry cannot possibly ever get enough of these helper meals, okay? So for the next 2 months, this is what we're collecting in the box out in the gathering room. We are blessed in our community to have people who donate hamburger, they donate chicken, we get tuna. But these families need things to turn them into meals. So if you need to know what to do when you go out of this place, when you're at the grocery store, put some helper in your cart and bring it to church on Sunday. Thank you, girls.
One more announcement. Speaking of Mission for Erie People, they have a really neat fundraising event. It's called Mardi Gras on the Farm. It's going to be held at the Hampton Green Farm on August 13th in the evening. It's a Thursday. At the event, there'll be a horse dressage. Does anyone know what that is? I had to look it up. They promenade along, and you get to see the horses. You also get to go to the barn and see the new foals and things like that. Also, there'll be dinner catered by Hearthstone. It's a Mardi Gras-style dinner with jambalaya and all sorts of goodies. And then following, there'll be dancing and music. Tickets are $25, or if you'd like to get a table for 10, they're $200. So see me after the service, and I'll have tickets available. Thank you.
Are there any other things our community needs to hear about? Okay. Well, I want to tell you a little bit about why we're here, why there are so many people in the front of the sanctuary wearing red shirts today. Last week, we've had a week to recover. And prior to that, the week prior to that, we spent serving in Perry County, Kentucky with Appalachia Service Project, ASP. And almost every face has been here a million times now and heard us say what ASP is, but I always say it again because it's important in case there's one person in here that doesn't know. Appalachia Service Project is a Christian ministry that strives to make homes warmer, safer, and drier in some of the poorest places in central Appalachia. The need is great. The situation for many families living in that area is bleak economically. The houses are in very bad shape, many of them. Some of the conditions that we see when we travel there are shocking, to say the least, for many of us here. But the purpose of ASP is to provide hope. I said it's to make houses warmer, safer, and drier, but There's another mantra that ASP uses all the time, and that is that it's a relationship-based ministry with construction on the side. And everybody who volunteers with ASP, I believe, truly takes that to heart. We go and we use hammers and we use saws and we use drills and we work hard, but it doesn't stop there. God is at work, and He works in the hearts and in the lives of the people we serve there through the relationships that we build while we're there serving. He works in our hearts in amazing ways, again, through the relationships that we build while we're there serving. Not only relationships with the families living in the homes, but relationships with each other as we work together. So we have a lot to share with you this morning. I hope you get a little sense of just how big ASP is. We took 30 people representing our church this summer. We combined with another church in Kalamazoo, and we've done this every year. We have one has shown up so far. Jake's already here from Kalamazoo, and we have some more coming for the second service. 28 people from Westwood United Methodist Church in Kalamazoo, and we come together as a team. So as you see the pictures, there's a lot of faces you might not know because it's part of that team. But to give you an idea, ASP has worked in about 500 homes this summer. If you consider a work crew working in a home is typically about 7 people, and some of the homes are only have a smaller number of projects and might only have a crew for a few weeks. Many homes have a crew there for an entire 7-week summer session. That's a lot of volunteers. So we experienced some great things, and we cannot wait to share them with you. We're going to be sharing again in the second service, so if you're watching the slideshows and a picture goes by and you just didn't quite catch it, say, we're going to show it again. We're also going to have some of the same faces here. We're going to have some others. Here's the thing, and I don't want to say this now. I don't want to wait till the end because I don't want to risk forgetting to mention this. As leaders with our youth group and with ASP, I want to extend a huge thank you to all of the parents and families that shared your amazing sons and daughters with us this week. I am so proud to be representing this church full of youth like you guys. I'm proud to be a Christian if you guys are what that means. If you're the ones representing us, if you are the ones that are going to continue to represent Christ in the world, you just make me all the more proud to be part of that. And parents, you should be very proud yourselves. Not only proud of the work that you've done, you know, we thank you for the work that you've done in preparing them this far, but thank you for sharing them. We understand that it's a very busy time, and so to share them for an entire week when they're already, you know, these people are serving in many ways. They're busy, they're active, they're doing a lot of things, and you shared them. Some of our youth couldn't be here today because once their families finally got them back, now it's time to do some family things, and we understand that too. Some of them had to work. If you happen to notice any of the employers around town that some of our youth have worked for, I know a couple of them, the Alpaca Farm and Putters Creek, and some, you know, different places that these guys work, that gave them up for a week. That's not always easy to convince a summer employer to do. So some of them had to be back at work again this weekend. But it takes a lot of people contributing to make this happen. So thank you all. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to sing a song that is historically important with ASP. It's something we sang while we were there this year, and we have every year that I can remember.
It was really great for me. I didn't actually go on the trip. I'm kind of an imposter that I have the shirt on. But every time I can get a free T-shirt, I'm like, hey, free T-shirt, great. However, while I wasn't on the trip, I love that Facebook is in existence because Doug especially and Nick and Kim, they were posting pictures of you guys on the trip and all the things you were doing and the fun you were having and the serving. And for me, it was particularly great to see members of our church helping lead the music and helping lead the worship that was happening many times. I don't know if you guys did that every single night, if you had music every night or most nights. It was just really great for me to see that. So this is the song, of course, that most people know. So please sing along with us. I believe the words will be up on the screen.
The splendor of the King. Thank you.
Please be seated. Before we do the scripture, Kim, don't advance it just yet. I'm going to take the microphone for a second and take some liberty. First off, I want to welcome into the room, if you haven't seen her, Ms. Kelly Bowes, who's Community United Methodist Church first ASB staffer. Kelly's going to share with us a little bit, but I think one of the things that's important that we'd like to lift is the four people that were our staffers down in Chavies, Kentucky. We were blessed to have Annie White, who is a young lady I've known for a long time, because she came from the Westwood Church, and she was our center director, along with Max and Matt and Jordan, who I was pleased to see on the porch in Jonesville for the closing week. Jordan had a pretty serious car accident during the week. It was on her day off. She was on her way to visit her family who were serving in another county, and she wound up in a pretty serious car accident. The car was totaled, but she survived quite nicely. And so she was on the porch with the rest of the staff. It was great to see her there and her smile. Those four young people are critical to the success of our week, just as Kelly was part of her staff, and she'll explain that more, I'm sure. But as we do our prayers this week, I would lift all of those staffers who are now making the transition, many of them, back to the real world, back to the world that's not the mountains. And I've lived through this once because my son was a staffer for a year, and that transition time is really important for them. And I know they spent some time talking about that and what it means to come back, because quite honestly, this is probably the best job that they'll ever have in their lives. Certainly the hardest job that they'll ever have in their lives, but it's a job that is so rewarding in so many ways. I'm looking forward to Kelly's comments today. I'm gonna bring to you the scripture. The scripture actually is printed right in front of you on anybody that's wearing one of these shirts. And I want to ask Lauren Anderson to step up, please. Stand up. Lauren and Grace and Maddie and some of these folks were really responsible for putting this T-shirt together, and I just want to give them recognition for great work. So. And I'd like to do this a little bit different. I'd like this theme verse is something ASP does every summer. They put that out in front of us, and we've talked about it in preparation before we left. And quite honestly, we talked a lot about it during the week. What it means to walk in the shoes of Jesus Christ if we say we follow him. And so what I would ask is a short verse. I'd ask you to read this with me, please, as a group. It's 1 John 2:6. Please. Whoever says, I abide in him, ought to walk just as he walked. And I'm going to invite the crew up to the porch now, and we're going to spend some time telling you a little bit how we walked as best we could in the footsteps of our Savior and our Messiah. So please, come on up to the porch. This is always kind of a free form, and I get to facilitate, and I'm really, really pleased with the numbers of folks that we have here. We've got a good, really good representation of the 30 folks that went down, and a guest also. Jake, you can sit in the rocking chair if you want. You know, are you pitching tonight? So if you want to sit in the rocking chair, you're welcome to. By the way, Jake Rouse, we got to celebrate when we were down there. He is an excellent pitcher for Kellogg Community College over in the Battle Creek area, but he's also now a Kalamazoo Growler, which is a Northwoods professional baseball league. He's not getting paid, so he has signed an end of the season contract with them and is finishing the season with them. So it's great to have an accomplished athlete with us as well. So. The way this works is I'm going to ask some questions. I'm going to give some warning because they didn't get a chance to talk to everybody here, but the questions are pretty general. We'd like you to describe your family, the people you work for, and I'd like to spread that out so that the different crews get, you know, treated. Also, the kind of work that you did, and maybe give the folks some sense of what it was like to work in that 90-degree heat, 95-degree heat, and some of the things that you accomplished. But then the third question is a question that we talked about on Friday night, which is, what is that God moment? What is that moment that will stick out in your mind where you saw the work of God in the mountains of Appalachia? So who would like first to describe their family? I need some hands. I'm going to need volunteers here, folks. Otherwise, I'm going to be starting naming names. I'm going to start with Kathy. I'm going to pick on her, but Kathy is a coworker of Nick and Kim's, and they've known each other for a while, and we recruited her onto the team. And so, Kathy, why don't you tell us about the family you work for?
Hi. Our family, basically, she was an elderly lady. I think she was 90? She was over 90, and she was in a home that had been in her family for over 100 years. And my understanding is it had been moved from its original location to where it currently is sitting. And the Appalachia Service Project had been working in her home all summer. And we were going to finish her kitchen. So she had been without a kitchen. She had her stove and her refrigerator and things out on her front porch. And so we came in and we had to finish drywall, which we did, and I am a pretty good mudder, if I do say so myself. So we taped and mudded the drywall, and we also had to put in some windows. We had to take out a chimney for an old coal stove. She was getting a new coal stove that they were going to vent in a different way, so we had to kind of figure out how to get that chimney out, and when we did that, we found that there was a bat who was residing in there, who probably was not very happy with us, but fortunately was able to fly out the window that we hadn't put in yet. And we had to put down some flooring. We didn't get as far in the project as we wanted to because the weather was so hot and humid that it took a while for the mud to dry for us to be able to sand it. And we needed to get the walls done before we started on the floors. One of the really cool things that we were able to do is she really wanted a blue kitchen. And the paint that we were provided with by ASP was a white paint. And with her having a coal furnace, we wanted to get something that she would be able to wash down because of the soot. So as a gift for her, our crew decided to buy her paint. So we all loaded up into the Pastor Craft and went to Lowe's and attempted to pick a color of blue paint that we thought would look good in the house. And getting seven people to make a decision is always a challenge. But we did pick out a blue paint, and we picked out some white ceiling paint as well, and we were able to go back and then paint the walls in the blue color that she wanted. And so we got the walls painted, we got the ceiling painted, we got it patched, we fixed the roof, and we were able to get the subfloor down for the flooring, but unfortunately we weren't able to finish and get the flooring down like we wanted to. We were
thank you. Kathy, I'm gonna ask you to pass that microphone on to Emma, and you'll be next, Emma. I'm gonna ask Elizabeth Pitcher, who is a recent graduate of North Muskegon High School, now heading on to college, who spent her last year as a youth, but certainly is one of our leaders in our J team. Talk a little bit about your family and how things went in your house.
Our family consisted of a dad, a girlfriend, and then two little girls, and they were just the darndest thing. Like, at first they were kind of quiet. All right, not the younger one. Brooke was not quiet at all. But Lacey was a little quieter, and she opened up really quick. We were building a room for them, and so they were really excited about it. And it was a new addition, and since we were week seven, we were doing the finishing touches. So we did the drywall, well, the insulation first, which was a lot of fun. And then finishing the drywall, and then we started mudding and sanding, and the little girls came in and, you know, like, we can do that. And I'm like, I don't know. You're little. And nope, they got a mask, they got gloves, they got glasses, and they helped us out, which was really cool because it showed me, like, they're not, it's not that they're not capable of doing it. You know, we're not there because they can't. We're there because we want help. So, but they were awesome. The family was so cool.
Thank you. Elizabeth, why don't you pass that to Megan? You get it next. I'll tell you what your question is in a minute. Emma, I'm going to ask you a rookie question. We have a few of the folks that were brand new, never been to ASP. We've talked about it. We try to prepare them as best we can, but you really can't for a week like this. So, Emma, what was your impression of Appalachia Service Project, and are we going to get you to go do this again?
Well, I'm definitely going to do it again, if that's answering one question. it was so much fun, and it was really eye-opening to me. From day one, or the first night, we stayed at a church, and we met up with the other team at Westwood. And from that night, we were all so open. I mean, I didn't know anyone, and nobody knew me. I was the newbie. And everyone was just so open, willing to get down and really deep. And so I think the overall impression, the one word that sticks out is vulnerable. And everybody was willing to get down and vulnerable. And I think that from day one, we really connected. I connected with people that I had never known and would never dream of getting close to, but we were able to get into such a raw state from the first questions that we had. So I think it was such an amazing thing that we really connected over that.
Thank you, Emma. I think that's a testimony to the work that the people do to get, you know, it took us some time to prepare, and I think the folks that come down, it used to be I would see a lot of youth that said, well, this will be fun. I'll go down with my friends. I'll do something cool. You know, I don't know what I'm getting myself into. But I think what's happening in this church, as has happened in the Westwood Church, is that the youth that went before come back and talk about why it's important, not just what we do, but why we do it and why it's important. So I think the people that come down are ready to have that experience. So I really appreciate the way you described that. Megan, would you do me a favor and talk a little bit about the center that we had and maybe some of the things that went on in the center?
I was a rookie as well, and I will definitely be coming back. It was a great experience. But after getting back from the work day for working for like 6.5-7 hours, all we really wanted to do was take a shower. And we had to wait, depending on what time you got back, the I think the kids 18 and under were top of the hour. And
that's right.
And then everybody else showered at from the bottom of the hour on. So it was hard to wait if we didn't get back in time, but it was fine. I don't know what everybody else did, but we did puzzles in the rec room and played ping pong and just watched everybody play other games and cornhole. And waited for dinner and ate dinner and then went out to ice cream every night. So, yeah.
I've given the microphone to Grace. I'm going to ask her to talk about our family and the work that we did. And you want to talk about Blue? Talk about Blue, will you?
So we had this amazing family this year, and the homeowner, Bertha, and then her husband, Larry. And then I'm still unclear on the family exactly, but there's a trailer next to us, somehow related. I think that's their daughter and her family. But there were all these people coming back and forth. And then there were a couple of girls. I don't know all the kids. They kind of hid from us. But Bertha and Larry, they joked around with us and we called him names, and he called us names, and it was fun. And so the work we did, we kind of split off into two groups. One group worked on kind of the finishing touches of the other house that other crews had worked on. So we'd put baseboard around this entire house, and then the other crew took out the floor in this other room all the way down to the joists, laid insulation, and put in a completely new floor. And then we painted that room. That was my highlight of the week on the work site. We painted that room Kentucky blue. So, yeah.
Thank you. I want to go to the final question, the God moment question, because we've got about 5 or 6 minutes left here. So we're going to start with an adult in the corner here. And so be thinking about what you would like to share as your God moment as I hand you the microphone.
For me, the place that I really was able to see God was that I can always see it in all the youth and the adults as they work, but what was really cool this year was that although we got to take Kelly last year as our first young adult leader, this year we got to actually have a crew of young adult leaders, that we had 4 that had come through, that had been many times before, and that we split them up amongst different crews, and I can speak for 2 of them because we had a double crew, but I've heard stories about the other 2, just watching those guys step up and become leaders themselves, to be able to say, look, hey, go do this. And they would take youth with them, and they'd show them how to do it, and they would go, and they would work, and they were ready to just make that transition. And so it was really cool to watch that, because I've seen it over these last years at Westwood, and, you know, as Rouse has come along and been a leader and watched those guys. But it's really cool to watch our first crew come through like that.
Thank you, Nick. I've given the microphone to one of those young adults, Jake Walton, who is who joined us after kind of a – he's been traveling a lot, having spent well over a month, right, a bunch of time in Chile. And then he barely had time to unpack before he joined us on the ASP trip. So, Jake, what was your God moment?
Like you said, this was my first year coming back as a leader.
Yes.
And a co-leader of the group, of a crew. And so I think my God moment would be taking a step back in a different perspective and just watching my crew work and just seeing God's love work through them, the youth, and just how happy they were to be working on this home. And I know that I've always been excited to be down there, but it's just so cool seeing so many other people just really wanting to share God's love and the blessings that we have here in this life, you know, down there with the people that are in so much need in Appalachia. So it's really cool.
Thank you, Jake. Becca, would you share yours with us?
Mm-hmm. I went with my dad as a rookie this year. He's not here right now, but it was neat to see that we could both, like, handle the mission trip together and be with each other and look across the room, and he'd just be there, and we could do it together as father and daughter, and I thought it was a really neat experience, and I just want to thank him for that.
Thank you, Becca. Maddie has said she would share.
My God moment would be, as Elizabeth said, we had 2 little girls, Brooke and Lacey, and Lacey wanted to play board games with Brooke, and Brooke was just not having it. She just did not want to play. She wanted to help out in the room. So Lacey was sitting on the floor, and we were in a small room, and it wasn't a lot of work for 7 of us because it was very small. And so I took that opportunity to go, and I sat with Lacey, and I sat there and I played a board game with her. And just the look on her face when I sat down just made my whole week, because I knew that she was very grateful for what we were doing for her, and she was very grateful for someone to just sit down with her. Because her parents, we didn't really see a lot of them throughout the week, so they were on their own a lot, so I thought that it was just amazing for me.
Thank you. Phil.
There are many, many ways in which I see God moments unfolding as we spend our time on the sites. But again, this year, I was reminded as we arrive and we see the work that we're to do, and it's kind of like handing off a baton from a previous team, in fact, several teams before us. There are things that we're saying, all right, you know, you did this great, we're going to build on that. And then there are other things where we're getting ready to mud, and we see, you know, doing somebody else's mudding that they've done the drywall for is kind of frustrating sometimes, because you're thinking, that gap's a lot bigger than I would have left, you know. And you've got to tape it and bed it and get it ready. Or the window that we had to remove because it was put in from the inside and it was supposed to come from the outside. And we had to put it in the right way. And yet, there were many things that were done well. And we still see ourselves as a part of a team. And we know that there are people that are going to make better what we did the week we were there as well. And it reminds me of the life of the church. We sometimes feel like we're here at Community Church, and we're here maybe, we feel like, for a long time, but we're really a part of a long, long stream of people at this church and in our faith as a whole. And we're here for this moment, and we'll do some things really fantastic, and we'll do some things that need other people to kind of correct some of the things that we weren't quite on task with. And that idea of being a part of a long race, and we're running the race, and we just want to run it well. And I love that kind of a sense of God connecting us and the God moment in being there at Appalachia.
Thank you, Phil. Lauren.
So as Kathy mentioned before, we were working for an elderly lady, and this house had been in her family for over 100 years. And when you walked into the house, there really wasn't much wall to see because of all of the pictures of family on the wall. She had about 20-plus grandchildren, and if you really sat down and took time with her, she would point to every single face on the wall and tell you the story behind that face and really where they came from that house. And in that moment for me, I really realized what the work we were doing was really about for her, was keeping that love strong from that house, and her being able to keep that house in the family was just an absolutely amazing feeling for me. So.
Thank you. Kim, would you share the last one?
I will. There were several moments that sort of came together in my mind on Friday night. On Friday night, everybody staying at that center shares around a circle how we saw God that week. And I know Jim can attest to how powerful that time is every year. But I think for me that was when some clarity kind of came to lots of little pieces that I had seen. We had an all-girl crew this year. Woohoo! And these ladies were amazing. And it's no secret that part of the goal with that was a sense of empowerment to help all of us know, every one of you and me, to help all of us know just how powerful God can be working in us. And that was kind of a cool experience. And I think that happened. I enjoyed watching that. I enjoyed watching these ladies, and I was honored to be a part of that team. And I enjoyed watching things like what Maddie described, and I'm really glad that you shared that, Maddie. The way the little girls at our work site responded to our crew of girls, you know, and how much fun that was to have them look up to these. These are some pretty great mentors for them. And then, you know, the same thing that Nick shared, watching our four guys, you know, Justin and Jake and Aiden and Matt, be leaders and remembering when they were freshmen and sophomores and totally new to all of it. Just the comparison is, there's no comparison. It's hard to describe the transformation that's happened in those 4 years in those guys. And I guess what finally occurred to me, it sounds like I'm rambling, but it took a combination of all of these thoughts and all of these pieces for it to really sink into me. You know, we talk about a ripple effect, and that was one of the messages in one of our evening gatherings early in the week. We talk about a ripple effect, but I don't know that we often really, really grasp the meaning of that. Seeing these guys from, you know, that 4 years ago were brand new, and seeing that transformation now, we don't know what conversations are going to be happening 4 years from now between Brooke and Lacey and their parents or their friends, or what's going to happen in their minds when someone tells them they can't, they need to just not. And maybe they remember that team of girls that took a room that was bare studs and put insulation in the ceiling and hung drywall and made it look like a bedroom, just the girls. And what conversations are going to happen amongst you guys or with your family later. it just occurred to me just how much all of this and all that we do when we're serving anywhere is a long-term investment, whether we realize it or want it to be or not. It's not for the short term. What we do day to day is not for today. It's a long-term investment.
Thank you. And I'm going to go to the last testimony from the porch. And it's a thank you. Thank you to you folks for your support of Appalachia Service Project, but also of me. Your prayer support has been really important. A year ago, I went to Appalachia Service Project on this stick. If you recall, I had an accident here at church and I was not able to go. And so my goal was to come back, was to be on this team this year. And I told them Friday night how important these people are in that recovery, how important you have been. But these kids, especially the youth, have inspired me all year long. They've made it important. They've made it really special. And it made me committed to being back with this team. I want to thank Nick and Kim for their leadership, Phil for his spiritual leadership and support of the team. But thank you all for your support in making this happen. I'd like to say thank you to these guys, and I wish you would thank them too as they come back to their seats. We need our ushers. Our ushers to go back. The offering will be accompanied by a slideshow. The kids talked about some of the work that they did. You'll get to see some of it now on these images. So.
On their own, when their lives.
We are so excited, as Doug said, that this year our first Community United Methodist Church staffer for ASP, and there she is, look at that. Kelly has agreed, she just got back, what, wee hours of this morning, maybe even not so wee, like late this morning, I don't know, from her summer serving as a staffer at ASP, and I hope she'll share a little bit about what that role is, but she's got lots to share with us, and we are so excited to have her. Kelly, we are so proud of you.
I'm used to like talking super loudly in front of volunteers, but this is a lot larger than what I'm used to. Wow, it's nice being in a rocking chair again. So I guess kind of to start, I can kind of explain what my role was as a staffer. Kind of what I expected was, this is going to be easy. The volunteers are going to do everything, and it's going to look great, and nothing will go wrong. That was completely wrong. That was like 180 of what it was. So I was given the role of volunteer coordinator on a four-person staff. I was in Fentress County, Tennessee, which if you remember from last year, we were in Morgan County. It's right next door to Morgan. It's right on the Cumberland Plateau. It collects a lot of storms, collects a lot of lightning. The lightning hits our school. The alarms all go off at 3 in the morning. It's great. Volunteers love it. We, not so much. But as the volunteer coordinator, I had the opportunity to kind of talk to the groups before they got down. And being a first-year staffer, I had no idea what I was supposed to tell them. So these like initial contact calls with their contact people were a little weird. They were like, so what are our projects going to be? And I was like, that's a great question. We haven't signed a single home yet. So you kind of just like make up things sometimes. Sorry to tell you that now, but that happens a lot. But something that I really like gained from being a staffer is problem solving right on the spot. Because when you end up at a home and they have just taken up a subfloor of a kitchen and the joists are just sawdust, and underneath the home you find 30 cans of green beans from 25 years ago all sitting in 2 feet of gray water. You hope it's gray water. You hope it's not black water. But you have like plans hoping that the joists will be great, the joists will be fine. No, there's no joists. The hardware store is an hour away. Like, you learn how to problem solve, and that's incredible to have on hand going into like a later job or something, but I guess that's something I never really thought I would learn on ASP, being a staffer. So gosh, there's so many stories I could share. There's definitely not enough time for all of them, and I'm sure you guys will hear them over and over. But I guess one that like really touched my heart over the course of the summer, we had an elderly woman that we were working for. Her name was Linda, and she was super sweet. You couldn't understand half the words she was saying, just because very thick accent. She couldn't understand what I was saying half the time either, which really surprised me because I don't know. But she's super sweet. But week 7, we had a group of volunteers come down from St. Giles, which was really weird because we volunteered with them my first year on ASP, and half of them were on the trip, and they were like, you look really familiar, and I was like, yeah, you do too, and then half the week we realized we were on the same trip, which was really cool but really weird being their staffer and once a volunteer with them. But there was a family in that group of volunteers who had just lost their grandmother, and they had to come down late because they had the funeral and everything over the weekend. And so they got in around midnight on Sunday night. And over the course of the week, the daughter who lost her grandmother grew super close with Linda and came to realize that Linda was like the spitting image of her grandmother and talked like her, walked like her, did everything like her. And the final day when she was going to leave, she just like sobbed in Linda's arms because she was like, it was like saying goodbye again because she knew she was never going to see her. And it was just so, it's really painful saying goodbye to the families that you get to know over the course of the summer, but even a week when you're there so long. And Linda's so sweet. She was like, call me anytime, like walked her out to the van, and just from the sound of it at Share Circle, it was just so meaningful that she would open up to a volunteer who spent a few days in her home like that. But there are endless stories like that. Gosh, there's so many things to share. Does anyone have any questions about staff? Doug said I could, like, open it up as, like, a panel. I don't know. Does anybody have any pressing questions? I don't know. I'm running on 3 hours of sleep. So if I make weird faces, just don't consider it as weird.
Why don't you tell them what your normal day was like, Kelly, during the summer?
Normal day, let's see. If I had hardware, I would wake up at 6 a.m., be on the road by 6:10, be at the hardware store by 6:30, get hardware, get back. Wake up is normally at about 7 a.m. We blast music through the hallways. Like, the second you're awake is the second that you're working. You have to, like, be super excited. Like, yeah, I love this song. I've heard it every single morning the entire summer, but you haven't. And so you're just, like, super obnoxious, making sure everyone's getting ready. You always have a smile on your face because you can never be upset as a staffer, which is, like, totally fine. I'm normally happy. But so wake up happens. Devo's at 7:15. Normally we have someone from the churches do that, and I noticed that our church took the opportunity to do a Devo while I visited, which was really great to see. And then once all the volunteers go out to their work sites, we call them runs. That's kind of not, that's an unfortunate name, but you get really close with your staff and everything becomes okay to talk about, if you know what I mean. And so we go out and we check out all the work sites, we check out all the homes, we go to every single home, one of us goes to every single home each day, we check on the projects, make sure the volunteers are doing okay. Again, problem solving, you never know when you're going to end up knee deep in black water until you're in it. So we'll go out on runs. We normally get back mid-afternoon. The volunteers get back later in the afternoon. You have dinner, evening gathering, and then after evening gathering, we try to go out to ice cream with our volunteers just because that's, like, a really great time to have fellowship with them and kind of become more of a vulnerable leader versus, like, being an authority in front of them. When you're sitting next to them and you just, like, talk about, like, hey, what do you want to do when you're older? Or, like, what's your favorite subject in school? Actually, we never talked about that. But it was more so, like, do you play any sports or do you have any siblings? And, like, things like that, just, like, getting to know them on a deeper level. That's the best way to connect with volunteers is spending quality time with them. And that was my favorite thing to do all summer because you get so many connections. I have, like, families from volunteers in Raleigh and in Chicago and in Baltimore and in Georgia and Florida, like, offering their homes to me if I'm ever in the area, which is super great. So after ice cream, we go back and we have a staff meeting, which could start at either 9:30, could start at 11:30. It varies, and then the time that it ends varies too. So sometimes you're going to bed at 12:30, sometimes you're going to bed at 1:30, and normally you're running on 5 to 6 hours of sleep, like, every day. So I didn't have any coffee over the course of the summer. That's impressive. But I'm having one now because I drove 12 hours yesterday, got home at 4. Sorry, Mom. So, yeah, that's kind of the course of our day. It just happens over and over that you kind of get used to it. So now that I'm home, I don't really know what to do with all this spare time, nor do I know what to do with a house where there's so much room or a normal bed. Sleeping on an air mattress was interesting. But, yeah, you really learn on staff. Like, a week is really great to be in the Appalachian Mountains, but for an entire summer, seeing that a family of 10 can fit into a single-wide trailer and somehow make it work, and yet you come home and you have all of this space and you only have a few people filling it, it makes you feel a little guilty. And like they were talking about earlier with the transition period, even just walking into my house, I just felt like I wanted to share space with my families. I wanted to bring them here. I wanted to bring them to a home where it's, like, it's properly insulated. And because some of the homes you can't always work for. We looked at least 50 homes, and we only signed 10. And the no calls are the hardest things you could ever make. That's probably the worst part of the job, is having to tell someone no. Because there's so much need, and there's so many people you want to help, but you can't help everyone. And I don't know if you guys have heard the starfish story, where, like, the kid is thrown in, like, one by one starfish into the sea, and the man comes up, and he's like, oh, like, why are you doing that? You're never going to get these thousands starfish. And he's like, well, I can't help all of them, but I helped that one. And that's a huge thing to recognize is for you guys. You helped that one family, and you can't help everybody. There's no way. You only have two sets of hands. But God put you in a place where you can really make a huge impact on that family. So I just, like, really appreciate you guys for what you've done. We as staffers can't say it enough to the volunteers who, like, take their time to do that. So any more questions? I have, like, a short thing I was going to read. It's kind of more of, I don't know. So during training for staff, we have 2 weeks of training on the porch, which is in Jonesville, Virginia. And on our final Friday night, we do, like, a talent show or whatever. And there's normally, like, two MCs that lead it. And a huge thing that we get as ASP staffers is people always ask us, how was camp? And it's like, ugh. Like, camp is great, but we weren't at camp. Camp is different. So they have this poem that I'm going to read for you guys. Most of you know what ASP is, so it makes a little bit more sense to you. But this is called I'm Not a Camp Counselor. It says, I'm not a camp counselor, so don't ask me how camp is, because I don't know. I'm not a camp counselor, because I know when the going gets tough, the tough call on God, who then directs them to our construction consultant, Dennis. But you wouldn't know who Dennis was if you were a camp counselor. So go ahead and pitch your tents while I call a man of mythical proportions to learn the 86 different ways to repitch a roof. I'm not a camp counselor who might fear that summer showers could cancel sailing lessons. No, I brave showers so cold that they make absolute zero seem laughable, not just once, but twice every week, in order to keep possibly the only job that's position power demands showers, sleeping days, and days off to its passionate, self-sacrificing, and filthy employees. I am not a camp counselor, so no, I am not impressed by the size of fish you caught, because I'm sure that trucker I caught out of Philly was at least 300 pounds heavier, and while your fish fry might be delicious, my ice-cold Coke was very refreshing. I am not a camp counselor, despite my affinity for camping gear, but you tell me a better way to relax in my classroom-made office than in an Eno hammock hung precariously from anything I could find. And although I might spend 70% of my time outdoors sitting in a van, you never know what Patagonia gear might be needed at an impromptu stop at a waterfall while found lost on initial home visits. And while you camp counselors may be able to swim in a 10-foot pool, can you swim after you've thrown yourself off a 30-foot rock? Sorry, Mom. Can you swim in midair while singing a song? Can you swim under a house in a pool of black water? Well, technically, neither can we. But sometimes you discover a plumbing problem only after you found yourself knee-deep in it. But you wouldn't know that if you were a camp counselor. I am not a camp counselor, and admittedly, a camp counselor might be better at tying knots than me, but a camp counselor has... But has a camp counselor ever felt the rush of glancing in her rearview mirror and seeing nothing but the beautiful blue, not of the Kentucky sky, but of the billowing tarp that is no longer preventing a half ton of dump from cascading out of the back of your truck at 60 miles an hour? No, I didn't think so. Because only an ASP staffer does not just watch for bats, but also for bat guano, for those of you who don't know, that is bat feces, rabies, and potential lawsuits. Only a staffer does not just feed farm animals, but feeds a pet pig an entire bottle of Mountain Dew in 4 seconds flat. Only a staffer can braid her fellow staffer's hair, another staffer's beard, and her own ungroomed leg hair faster than a local can skin a cat. Only a staffer is nostalgic for the smell of barbecue, but even more so for the smells that would make the common man gag. But I am not the common man. I am an ASP staffer. I am proud of the work I do, and I am proud of the families I serve, and I am proud of the construction I finish vicariously through volunteers. I'm so proud of the organization I work for and the people who make a porch feel more like home than anywhere on earth. And yet, I am no more important than you, dear camp counselor, for you serve God in your way and I serve God in mine. But let me add just this. On Monday morning, while you had an awkward conversation with a 6-year-old girl about peeing in the pool, I had an awkward conversation with a 60-year-old general contractor about our budget. On Wednesday afternoon, while you helped that girl blow bubbles, that man gave me bubbles when he was my dad of the day. On Friday night, while you held that girl as she cried about her skin knee, I held that man as he bawled about the little girl on the worksite who changed his life. So as important as both of our jobs may be, for God's sake, don't call me a camp counselor, for I am particularly proud of the region I served, the Appalachian families that I call friends and now family, and the work that has made me physically, intellectually, emotionally, and spiritually exhausted and exhilarated in a single day. I want to be heard, and I want to be recognized, so I can help others hear a region that is so often silenced. So please tell me all your camp stories, but after, let me tell you what it's like to be an ASP staffer. Thanks.
Kelly's, you don't know what the ripple will be for you. You have inspired us. You've inspired our youth. I know. So thank you very much. We're gonna close the service with Kim, the first and third verse of "Here I Am, Lord," and then we have our final kind of the fun slideshow. You're certainly welcome to stick around and watch that as we close our service with that, and then Phil will send us out with a ascending forth. So thank you.
Please stand and join.
Matt, thanks for your work and leading us in music today. Really appreciate it in this service. And now as we go from this place, let us go remembering that we're always entering a field of mission. No matter where we go, God is calling us to be a light that shines on a mountain. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, go in peace. Amen.
Many a dream has died, like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So live.